So we've got two parts. The first part, we're going to talk about workplace harassment, and then the second part, we're going to talk about workplace violence. So in terms of harassment, this survey has been done a number of times in terms of what is the most important factor in job satisfaction. And a lot of people think, oh, it's money. If I make a lot of money, I'm going to be happy. Or it's my job security. If I know I have a job for life, I'm happy. And study after study has showed that it's respect, and that companies who do that try to build on their culture and reinforce respectful behaviors do the best. So respect is the key to productivity. You want to get the most out of your organization, and that rests in the people that you have, whether it's the volunteers, whether it's the staff. You're reliant on these people to make the organization successful. And it's all about treating others how you want to be treated. So there's a number of disrespectful behaviors, and I've got a few slides on disrespectful behaviors. It's not to say that any of these would necessarily be harassment. We're going to talk a lot more in depth about what harassment is, but just generally, these are disrespectful behaviors that we should try and avoid in the workplace. And this involves whether you're communicating with staff, with a volunteer, and even amongst each other on the board of directors. So bullying, violence, threats of violence, those are all pretty heavy, obvious. Swearing and profanity, rude behavior, making fun of colleagues, gossiping or spreading rumors, cutting someone off mid-sentence, routinely interrupting others' conversations. And this, I'll talk a little bit about bullying as well, because bullying is something that's, it's a form of harassment, but it's often subtle behaviors where people are not including somebody in the workplace and not giving them the resources to do the job. But these are all types of bullying behaviors as well. Berating a peer or subordinate in front of others, and tampering with personal property. So if you you might think you're playing a joke on someone and taking away their mouse from their computer station or taking away their pens, but that is a form of bullying. It's not always, you have to sort of be conscious of, is this funny? Would I think this was funny if I was really busy and I went back to my desk and couldn't find my mouse or my screen was locked? So it's sort of to look on things in a new perspective, and not that we want to take all the fun out of the workplace, but just to have that second thought of, is this behavior really appropriate? Lack of appreciation, loudness, not responding to voice or email, intruding on someone's personal space, habitual lateness for meetings, or answering calls or messages during meetings, that's all disrespectful behavior that you should try and cut out and focus on why you're where you are and who you're with, to focus on them. So there's two acts in Ontario that covers workplace harassment. The first is the Ontario Human Rights Code, and more recently, the Occupational Health and Safety Act was amended to also include protections for employees on harassment. So under the Human Rights Code, harassment is a course of comments or actions that are known or ought reasonably to be known to be unwelcome. So that's any behavior that demeans or belittles or embarrasses someone else, that viewed objectively, someone else, so this is the reasonable person that ought reasonably to be unwelcome. If someone were to tell me that this happened, would I say, yeah, that's, I wouldn't want that to happen to me. No one would really want that. So that's sort of, can you really expect that that would be unwelcome? And it's freedom from harassment on prohibited grounds. So in Ontario, and these are similar as well, if you have substantive sort of employment in the provinces, some of these prohibited grounds of discrimination differ, but in Ontario, these are the prohibited grounds of discrimination. So if you're making comments or jokes or making decisions based on someone's race, their place of origin, their citizenship, their age, all of those are grounds for someone to go to the Ontario Human Rights Tribunal and say, I've been discriminated against based on my age, or based on my sex, or based on my marital status, based on my family, because I have children, they're discriminating against me. Yes. Under the Occupational Health and Safety Act, it's a little bit different in terms of the definition for harassment. It's engaging in a course of vexatious comment or conduct that is known or reasonably to be known to be unwelcome. So this, one incident could be offensive enough to qualify as harassment under the Ontario Human Rights Code or under the Occupational Health and Safety Act. What the Occupational Health and Safety Act brings in is that it's not on a prohibited ground. It applies to all workers. So if two white men were having a disagreement and didn't like each other and they went to the Ontario Human Rights Code, the question would be, well, why are you here? What's your prohibited ground? You've got nothing. Under the Occupational Health and Safety Act, now it applies to everybody, and everybody has to be protected from harassment. So it doesn't matter that I'm harassing you for no other reason than I don't like you. Now you've got recourse under the Occupational Health and Safety Act. Under the Occupational Health and Safety Act, there's actually specific provisions that are applicable to directors and officers. And your responsibility under the Act is to take all reasonable care to ensure that the corporation complies with the Act, orders of inspectors and directors, and orders of the minister. And there is liability that an individual who fails to comply is guilty of an offense, and they can be fined up to $25,000 and face 12 months in jail. So there is personal liability that comes on to directors of a corporation. Now, this is also something that you would have to know about. You would have to condone it. You'd have to, the defense is due diligence. Did you take all the steps reasonable in the circumstances to protect your workers, to protect the volunteers? Just to provide some sort of real life examples, these are fines that have been made under the Occupational Health and Safety Act. There have been none to date under the harassment and violence provisions of the Occupational Health and Safety Act, but there's precedence under the Act already for fining directors individually. So in the first situation, it was a director who failed to ensure that their workers were using safety belts. They were crawling up the side of a building somewhere, and I think they were on the roof of somewhere. And one had a safety belt on, and the other three didn't. And the director pled guilty. He said, yep, you know what? I failed to take all reasonable precautions to ensure compliance with the Act, and he was fined $3,000. In the second one, the director was... Second one, the company itself was fined $30,000, and the director in this case was doing nothing to help the ministry actually enforce the orders. The inspector had been on site a number of times. He'd issued orders to the company to say, you have to do X, Y, Z. The director wasn't doing it. He wasn't following up. He was actually, when the inspector came back the second time, it was a different inspector, and he pled ignorance in terms of the first inspector being there and generally being a bit of a idiot. So he was slapped with $8,500 personally that he had to pay. And in the third one, $12,000, in this example, the worker actually died. It was a fall that had happened, and the director in that case was fined $12,000 for not making sure every precaution was taken for the safety of the workers. And I sort of reiterate that safety now includes violence and harassment. And the last one I actually found interesting because this was an incident. They were building a house and they were putting down, they had put all of the, I'm not a construction person, so I'm not going to get the terms right at all, but they had put down all the cross beams, and then they were building the floor, and a guy backed up and fell through the hole, and it was more than 3 meters, and he hurt his back and he suffered back injuries. And the director in that case, they were supposed to have put up guardrails so that there was no open area for anybody to fall through. So he put up the guardrail right away to protect future workers. And he was fined $2,500 because he disturbed the scene of accident. So even though he was protecting, work shouldn't have continued, and he should have left the accident scene completely undisturbed until the ministry had come and done their inspection. But he had actually done this in good faith to protect people, and he was fined for disturbing the accident scene. So I did that little segue just to sort of impress upon you that there can be significant consequences for not being aware of what your duties are and for not following through on those duties. You can't put your head in the sand and say, I don't want to know. And certainly not now that you've attended this training. It's all up front that you know what your responsibilities are under the Act. So back to harassment. Everyone's entitled to a workplace free from harassment. This is both in the code and the Occupational Health and Safety Act. And workplace harassment includes anywhere that the employee is. So as long as they're doing work-related functions, that's the workplace. It's not limited to this building. It's not limited to if there's a conference somewhere, just that conference. If they're at home talking on the phone to you and you're talking about business related to the workplace, then that's the workplace. And that telephone conversation is subject to the same rules. And I would even go so farther than that, that if you are in a, if you like any relationship that you have with a volunteer or a staff, to be cognizant that that conversation is likely going to be a work-related conversation. It's hard to take that hat off and just be, you know, buddy-buddy with the, with volunteers or other board of directors. You should always be conscious of the fact that you should be thinking people should be treated with respect. So harassment can be pretty broad. It can be physical, verbal, nonverbal gestures. I'm sure we can all imagine some nonverbal gestures. Psychological, visual, putting up pictures or putting up, you know, the sunshine girl. Does that even still exist? I don't know. People who are from Ottawa, I forgot my audience isn't all from Ottawa, but it can be sexual harassment, which we'll talk a little bit more about, racial, personal, abuse of authority, and now electronic as well. You can, there have been cases found where people posting things on Facebook, people posting things on Twitter that are completely unacceptable have been found to be harassment and can be called cyberbullying. So to break it down, it's harassment is what is known or ought to be known, but the intention to harass is not required. Just because I didn't mean it, I can't say, no, that's not what I meant. If from that person's perspective that they felt this way, I can't control how they feel. And even if a reasonable person, so the first part is the objective, would a reasonable person find that the conduct or comment was unwelcome? But then the second part of the test is, was it unwelcome? And this becomes subjective to that person that was sort of the recipient of that harassment. Does the complainant consider the conduct or comment to constitute harassment? So back to the intent versus impact. Statements such as, I didn't mean anything by it, or I was just joking, aren't excuses and they're not defenses. I know I worked for a federal organization that had a number of Eastern European men who were managers, and they didn't have the same sort of concept as personal space as it seemed Canadian men did. And I had complaints come in and I had to talk to the managers and say, you've got to back up. Like, you've got to, don't be so touchy-feely. Don't touch the people. Well, I don't, it's just, this is my culture. Like, yes, but I get it's not your intent, but you have to recognize that, you know, I wouldn't even say as soon as someone complains, because they shouldn't be doing sort of that, the personal touching in the first place, but definitely I don't welcome this type of behavior. I don't want this type of behavior. Then it has to stop. What is relevant is the impact of the behavior on that recipient. So if that person felt like you were in their personal space, that it was inappropriate and it was inappropriate touching, that's enough. It has to stop. So sexual harassment, this is sort of when everyone started talking about harassment in the workplace, we started focusing on sexual harassment first because it was sort of easy to identify what is sexual harassment. And it's anything that is that could detrimentally affect the work performance of someone. Like the quid pro quo means, you know, you do this for me and I'll give you this promotion. Something to benefit somebody in a sexual way in order to advance their career. A hostile work environment. This is more subtle behavior. It could be, you know, leering at someone, the lewd gestures, not as obvious, and it sort of takes more time to, not more time, but sort of a the course of conduct that happens over a period of time that when looked at in total, you can look back and say, yes, that was inappropriate behavior. But to say, you know, one lewd gesture, or one leering glance is sexual harassment would be difficult, but that sort of takes that course of conduct in order to qualify sort of as a hostile work environment. And conduct of a sexual nature, so this is the vulgar remarks, the touching, it could be displaying inappropriate pictures in your workstation, would be conduct of a sexual nature. So examples of sexual harassment is derogatory or inappropriate comments, insults, slurs, taunting, suggestive looks or gestures. Certainly, you know, if you're a female and you walk by a construction site and you get the wolf whistles, that's sexual harassment. So that shouldn't be happening on a construction site or here, but that's an example of what is sexual harassment. Display or circulation of inappropriate written materials or pictures, and unwelcome or unsolicited sexual advances. So bullying's harder to put your finger on because it does require that course of conduct, and it really is. It's intentional. It's people who are trying to ostracize someone from the workplace. And it's usually irrational, unfair, unpredictable. And it includes more than just the enumerated grounds under the Human Rights Code. So this applies to all workers in the workplace. And I'm just going to go back to bullying because I've had a few investigations that I've had to do with employers where they've asked me to look into the relationship between two employees because one employee is saying that they're feeling bullied. And it really is hard to try and establish whether or not it's happening because it can be really subtle things. But examples would be singling out a coworker in front of others, acting with condescension, gossiping or spreading rumors, interrupting that person, sending hostile emails, and withholding resources for them to do their job, intentionally not inviting them to meetings where they should be at based on their position. And it sort of that whole dynamic has to be looked at holistically to determine whether or not there is bullying. And it's a difficult process to go through, but it happens in the workplace more frequently, I think, than we actually know, because a lot of people just quit. Why do I want to work here? Why do I want to put up with this? I want to take care of my own happiness, so I'm not working there anymore. And unfortunately, that bully stays in the workplace, and it takes a lot for someone to actually put their hand up and say, I think I'm being bullied. And it's if anyone's gone through an investigation, any type of harassment investigation, it really is tough for the person who's been complained against, especially if it's something that, and I know intention isn't a part of it, but especially when it was something that may have been taken out of context and there really was no intent. But bullying is the same thing. Like it divides the workplace into, you know, a winner and a loser. And, you know, we're going to talk about the policy that we have in place and the confidentiality of it, but it becomes a more stressful environment. And not to say, you know, people should feel free to bring their concerns forward, but there's a lot of reasons why people don't. And that's what part of this training is to promote the education of what this is, so people feel comfortable coming forward and saying, this is what's happening to me, knowing that Equine Canada is going to look into it and to investigate it. Oh, and I skipped. So what is not harassment? The word harassment is actually a lot more loosely used than I would like, because people will say I'm being harassed, but there's a lot of behavior that isn't harassment. Legitimate, my last slide was do not confuse harassment with work-related stress or personality conflict, because there can be personality conflicts. We don't expect everybody in the workplace to get along and love each other, but you have to learn how to work with another person. And you may not like their personality, but it doesn't mean that it's harassment and that they're harassing you. So an exercise of management rights. We still want management to be able to do their job and not feel like their hands are tied, that they can't do certain things because somebody's going to cry harassment. And so this is always stressed, and it certainly was when Colleen did the training last time, in terms of what's not harassment. It's imposing a work structure, modifying tasks, any disciplinary measures, evaluating work performance, request for an explanation for lateness or absence. This one happens so often that it surprises me. Someone's absent for a week, and as the employer, we say, okay, great, can you give me some kind of documentation to support this, a medical note? Well, you're harassing me. No, I'm not. I'm allowed to do this. As the employer, I'm allowed to ask you for this, and 100% you still are. But that's when certainly a trigger I find is for employees to say that they're feeling harassed. An abuse of authority. So abuse of authority is a form of harassment, and it's when managers or supervisors use their power inappropriately. So they can humiliate, intimidate, threaten, coerce because they're the manager. They have this power over employees to make them do things. And that's an abuse of authority and considered harassment. Excessively criticizing employees, constantly scrutinizing employees' work, and essentially the last bullet summarizes what abuse of authority is. It's the improper use of one's power over others. So what is not an abuse of authority, again, is counseling, performance appraisals, corrective discipline, attendance management, all of those things management is allowed to do with the proper authority. In terms of consequences to the employer, when you have employees who are being harassed, this is how it affects the bottom line. There's a higher rate of employee absenteeism, there's a higher rate of sick leave, reduced productivity, increase in employee turnover, because again, a lot of times people just say, I don't want to deal with this. I'm walking away, submitting my resignation. And so you've got to deal with that turnover. Increase in workplace stress and potential litigation costs. If someone were to actually, if they quit, they can turn around and say, well, I was forced to quit because I was in a poisoned work environment and I had no other choice. So I'm now suing Equine Canada for constructive dismissal. And then that's a whole new ball game, but very costly litigation fees in order to defend yourself against that. And intangible costs, difficulty in recruitment and retention. If there's, if in the community there's a reputation that this is a bad place to work, that turnover is so high because management isn't doing anything and there's bullies and whatever, you're not going to be able to try to fill these positions. You're going to have decreased workplace morale, strain in workplace relationships, reduced corporate image, poor public relations, and decrease in trust in management. So for all of these reasons, we want people to feel comfortable coming forward so that we can deal with the root of the problem to make sure that people do feel respected in the workplace. So essentially the purpose is the prevention of harassment in the workplace, and it covers all employees, volunteers, and members and officers of the board of directors. And as I said earlier, it's all activities that occur while on EC premises or while engaging in EC business activities or social events. So it really is a broad policy that covers everybody at any time if they're doing business for the work for Equine Canada. This is in the policy. We have a commitment to promoting a harassment-free workplace, investigating reported incidents, taking necessary action, and providing support for complainants. And the first three items on this stage are actually legislated. The Occupational Health and Safety Act says that you have to do that. Employees have to know how complaints are going to be investigated, and they need to know what steps the employer is going to take. So the definition in the policy is the broad definition from the Occupational Health and Safety Act, not the more restrictive one from the code, which is just on the prohibited grounds. And it includes examples of workplace harassment, which we've gone through already. And it talks about how to report workplace harassment incidents. So again, this is what's legislatively required. So all employees know that this is what they should be doing. And if anyone does come to you and if they're outside of, you know, they're trying to do number one and talk to someone informally, but maybe they need assistance, they want to talk to somebody on the board, really try to encourage them to talk to the person directly, because once you get into the formal investigation, it really is that sort of winner and loser. And a lot of times it's the context and the intent of the person that just needs to be clarified to realize that this can be easily resolved. I certainly encourage anyone who calls me to really promote number one, to have that informal conversation. And a lot of people aren't comfortable doing that on their own, but even offer to do it on their behalf instead of getting into that formal investigation. You know what? I don't mind. If you're comfortable with me talking to that person, I can ask them what they meant by that. And then the next steps are they can seek support to communicate their objections, submit a formal complaint. Certainly, we're asking employees to always record details of the incident. And if anyone does happen to contact you to ask for help, take some notes of it, because if it gets to a formal investigation, we may need to look at those notes as well. If they said that they've talked to you, what did they say to you? What did you do? What did you recommend to them? Complaints are to be filed within a reasonable period of time. Oh, and actually, what is good about your policy, well, I think it's good from my perspective, is because harassment really can be overly used in terms of saying I'm feeling harassed, your policy says that everything will be taken seriously, but only complaints that fit the definition of harassment are investigated. So it's not that every single complaint will absolutely get to the investigation, and it's a distinction that you should be aware of only if someone says, well, I brought a complaint forward and they never investigated it. Well, on its face, even if it were true, if it wouldn't be harassment, the company's not going to go through all of these resources to prove that. So reporting workplace harassment incidents, if there's a complaint against a CEO, it's to be filed with the president of the board. And if it's a complaint regarding a member of the board, it goes to the CEO. And non-employees, complaints regarding non-employees go to the CEO. And confidentiality, we stress this, that especially in smaller workplaces, people talk and people tend to know when something's happening. And as much as possible, confidentiality needs to be stressed. A, if you happen to have a complaint against you, you wouldn't want everybody in the workplace talking about it. And two, it does compromise the investigation. If I've got Joe, Sally, and Anne, and Joe and Anne have been talking this whole time, and I'm interviewing them separately, they don't have independent memories now of what actually happened. Anne might be telling me something that she just knows from Joe, but didn't actually hear or see it herself. So we really try and discourage anyone gossiping about it. If employees do have something to say, encourage them to go talk to the CEO. And there's no anonymity when you're filing a complaint. And that's sort of another thing that I stress with employees, that they need to know that just filing something saying, I'm not happy with Joe, but not signing your name against it, if you were Joe, you wouldn't want that to be given the same sort of level of scrutiny if it's going to be anonymous. If that behavior is happening, you need to know, because if that was against you, you'd want to know, well, what did Anne say? And let's hear all of the allegations that she has. So it's to be as transparent as possible. So I jumped ahead of myself, but all reports of workplace harassment will be taken seriously and will be documented, but only if they're a violation of the policy will they be investigated. CEO will assign an investigator. The investigator will talk to any witnesses, talk to the employee, talk to the complainant and the respondent, and everyone will be told about the confidentiality requirements. So the investigator will ultimately determine whether the evidence supports a finding of a violation or not. They'll prepare a written report, and the CEO will make a final decision on what's going to happen based on the final report. Documents are kept for up to 2 years, but it's separate from an employee file. So they won't ever be in the employee file unless there's discipline comes out of the harassment investigation. So employee and volunteer responsibilities: act respectfully, report any incidents, understand and comply with the policy, cooperate with investigations, and participate in training. EC responsibilities: they will provide the training, promote a harassment-free working environment, designate a workplace coordinator to ensure compliance with the policy, review reports, and facilitate support. So if there is support needed for a victim, they will arrange for that support to happen. In terms of consequences, so if somebody violates this policy, they're subject to disciplinary action, and this is for volunteers or employees. And the following three instances here could also result in discipline. So if a manager, an employee, if they're aware of, or it's a manager specifically, if they're aware of harassment and permitted it to take place and did nothing about it, they can be subject to discipline. Employees or volunteers who bring forward complaints in bad faith: they want the person to get into trouble, but they've made up the allegations, and it's discovered that they've made up the allegations, they can be disciplined. And employees or volunteers who've made false accusations, I guess, which is just the example I did. So if they did it for bad faith or vexatious reasons as well. And reprisals will not be tolerated. And employees really often, this is their main reason why they don't want to bring something forward, because they feel it's just going to get worse, or they feel that whether it's a reprisal against them or a reprisal against someone else in the workplace, this is why they don't bring it forward. So this is underscored in the training to employees that we won't tolerate reprisals. And if anyone is aware of a reprisal happening from bringing a complaint forward, they have to tell us about it because it won't be tolerated. And then the policy will be reviewed regularly. It will, and employees will be given training at least every 3 years. And that's harassment in a nutshell.